Paul, American progressives are having a tough time overcoming their disappointments for what we've seen out of what we thought was going to be the change candidate. That's a dangerous thing for us right now, isn't it? For us to have to be so disappointed that we don't jump back into the fight the way we've had to do over the last 8 years.
I think it is very dangerous, because what happens is you end up with this sort of cycle that sort of says, and in some ways it actually started right after the election, is, okay, we've done our job. Now, here it is. You guys take care of it. And that's not how change works. It never has been. There was a young woman I interviewed for the new version of Soul of a Citizen who founded Students for Obama on Facebook, and she said, people have this illusion that here's your candidate, here's their platforms, they get elected, they become law. And as we know, that's very far from the reality. And I think one thing that happened fairly early on is that people sort of kind of sat back and started watching, as opposed to jumping in and going to those town meetings or rallying in the streets or doing door-to-door canvasses or any of those other things to change the dialogue. And we sort of left the void for the Tea Partiers, who, of course, you know, funded by Koch and all those folks, gladly seized it.
Yeah, yeah. We have to admit that the disappointments are real. They're justified, and people do have they have reason to be angry about the lack of change that we thought we were going to get. But I think we have to start with those disappointments. What do you think the disappointments are? If you were to
first of all, I completely agree. I mean, everybody has slightly different issues, but you know, it's whether it be that we didn't get a public option, which shouldn't have been a complete surprise since it was part of Obama's platform, but you know, that we're in Afghanistan, or that we didn't get justice for the Bush folks, or don't ask, don't tell, or that we don't have a climate change bill. I mean, there's a list of what we don't have, and it's a pretty significant list. I mean, I can go on the other side and talk about some, you know, good underappreciated things that have happened. The biggest best student loan financial aid package since the Pell Grants, Lisa Jackson pretty much shutting down mountaintop removal, that we will have 30 million people covered if the Republicans don't reverse it. I mean, you can go on a list on both sides.
Yeah, it is
not
a good
what we
list.
Hoped for.
Look, well, part of it has to do with kind of those lofty campaign promises.
Absolutely, and the notion of a candidacy of change that all of us threw our hearts in, and I think maybe we believe the rhetoric too much. It's not to say that it was false, but it's to sort of say that there's a missing piece, and the missing piece was our action.
And so what we were doing is we were saying as progressives, we've created enough energy. The energy is going to affect the change. Those lofty promises that Obama was making, we've done enough. It's up to Obama now.
Right, exactly.
And so the first thing we saw, and this is what everybody misses, and I know you don't miss this. The first thing Obama did is surrounded himself with the same knee-jerk conservatives that surrounded Bill Clinton. Okay, so right now, if we do what we want to do because we're pissed off, if we do what our instinct tells us we should do because we're disappointed and in what we've actually seen take place, what's the downside to that, to not showing up? Talk about that. Let's talk about the fear of that.
Well, I mean, it's very real, because if you look at the Republican candidates, some of them make George Bush look like a moderate. I mean, they're people who are basically, you know, let's gut Social Security. Review. There was a guy running, Dino Rossi, in Washington State, and he had this phrase. He's running against Senator Patty Murray, who's, you know, I give Patty a B. She's not great, but she's not terrible.
Mm-hmm.
And Dino Rossi said, there's a debate on climate change between scientists and pseudoscientists. And I'm like, yeah.
And
you're lining up with a pseudoscientist.
Yeah.
You know, there's every scientific academy in the world versus a guy from Exxon, and you're lining up with the guys from Exxon.
Okay, so
that's at stake.
Okay, so who takes over? I mean, we have John Boehner that takes over.
Right, and Mitch McConnell.
Mitch McConnell takes over.
And these are folks who absolutely have never stood for a single progressive thing in their life, have opposed everything. I mean, you know, they're not the old Everett Dirksen-style Republicans. They're scorched earth. And so if we think it's going to be difficult, it has been difficult at this point, you end up with, you know, potentially, as when Gingrich was in there, where they spend the entire time leading investigations of every Obama program.
Well, that's what they've promised us, isn't it?
This is not even the stuff we don't know about. Yeah. This is what they've already said.
Yeah, Michelle Bachmann, Boehner have come out and said, we're going to spend all of our time for the next 2 years until the presidential election issuing subpoenas, carrying on investigation, and government is going to come to a standstill. This is what their leadership says.
Right.
So we're out here saying, as progressives, really? You know, at some point in my past, I was able to hold my nose and vote for a conservative. But they have killed the conservative movement within their own party. It's dead. They've folded up their tent. So now, where we're left, where we are right now, is you are, you know, right on the threshold of national elections that could put people like Boehner and Mitch McConnell and Jeff Sessions and Michelle Bachmann
in huge power.
They could put them in power. If they take control, they could put Sarah Palin in a position of power. You understand that?
Yeah, absolutely.
They could put Joe the Plumber. What we're looking at here is a major ground shift. And if we stay at home, you know, we're going to have to live with it another 8 years.
And I think the challenge is to recognize that our efforts matter. I mean, on one of the blogs, somebody said, "Oh, you know, so big deal? What's the volunteering worth? A couple of percentage points." I went back and looked.
And
it's more than that.
Oh yeah.
You know, it's probably 10. But even if it was 2, in the last 2 elections, a couple of percentage points gets you John Tester, Jim Webb, Jeff Merkley in Oregon, Claire McCaskill, Al Franken. I mean, to go down the line, and there's like 8 senators within 2 or 3 points that we elected.
I think if we do what we're supposed to do, though, we put a blockade in this road, this freight train road that's been created by billionaires that simply are nothing more than inheritance babies. The Koch brothers.
And we also, there's another thing that happens out of that, which is we build our own power.
Yeah.
And that's equally important. I mean, this is, again, what I write about in the Soul of a Citizen book, is that we have to be able to get past disappointments and also recognize that it's our efforts that shift the landscape. And in some ways, I mean, one of the dangers the last 2 years is that because of all these wonderful new technologies that we have, that we sort of sit back and we think, oh, well, I clicked on a petition, I signed an email letter to my congressperson, I'm done for the day.
Yeah.
And it's not that those things are bad. I mean, I do them, you know, practically every day I click on some petition or online letter, but they're not sufficient.